This is Coons 4 Terp Talk with Bruce Posner. 60 minutes of Maryland athletics and your phone calls at 410-481-1300. Now, here's Bruce Posner and Terp Talk.
Well, it's a pretty sad day in the sports world today. The great Bruno Sammartino passed away. And one of the guys growing up with that we all loved and watched on wrestling, and we'll get into that later. But right now we have the current, is she on?
I'm here.
The current national championship coach for women's lacrosse, and whose team is resting in second or third in the polls, however you look at it. And that, of course, is Cathy Reese. Cathy, welcome in. And I've certainly talked to you a lot since the title, but I've never had a chance to congratulate you on the air, and it's never too late to be congratulated for another title, is it?
Hey, it's never too late for that. Thank you so much. It's good to talk to you. How are you doing?
It's great to talk to you. I'm doing great and looking forward to tomorrow night's game against Penn State and the continued success of both of our lacrosse programs, especially this year, has been a big help to get me through the year. I'll leave it at that.
Hey, it's been a great season so far. We're having a lot of fun, getting better every day, and that was our goal when we started out. So, yes, we welcome Penn State to town tomorrow night, close by one of my former teammates, so that's always fun to have them. But it's always a good game, great Big Ten competition. They're a really talented team, and so we know it's going to be a hard-fought game.
So they're sitting at 3-1 in the conference, because we're only talking conference now, because that's what matters for the next couple weeks.
And where we are, yep.
You're sitting 4-0, and your good friend is sitting at 4-0 also at Northwestern. So you have
so we got two top coaches to face over the next 2 weeks. But like we talked about today as a team, you know, we got to take this one at a time. Both these teams in the Big Ten are really strong, and we know it'll be again a tough game. But looking forward to it. We're looking forward to being back home. We were at Ohio State last weekend, had a great win there. Watched Megan Whittle break Jen's career goals record out there. Miserable weather, but all in all, a great game for the Terps. So it's nice to be back home in front of our own fans and play it at our complex.
Was it raining as hard as it looked on TV?
It sure was. You know, there was nothing to be hidden there. The first half was all right, but in the second half, my goodness, it just opened up and starting to come down. So it was, you know, all in all, a really good day for us. We had made some changes since the Princeton game, and it was nice to see our players really put them into action and come away with a great play on both ends of the field and come away with a win.
You know, we always talk about the scores and everything, and before we talk about the Penn State game, because they do present quite a strong opposition. I got to talk to you about a 5'5" sophomore on your team who's been defensive player of the week four times this year. I think she's only a sophomore, and that's Lizzie Colson.
Yeah, pretty fun, right? She's so fun to watch.
She is, I don't know what the right word to use it, but unusual for a sophomore to be so dominant so early in her career.
Yeah, you know, Lizzie had such a great high school career as a midfielder, played a lot of offense, and probably holds some scoring records in Carroll County, and came in and got a lot of time for us in her freshman year as a midfielder, and then moved down to the defensive end as the season progressed. And then her first start last year was in the Final Four when Alex McKay was out. So it was, for her, like, here you go, we're throwing you out there as a freshman starting in the Final Four and then the national championship. But to come in now and take a role in our defensive end, and she, you know, is leading our team in all sorts of things. Ground balls, cause turnovers, she's on the circle on the draw. She's so fast and so fun to watch and a really good defender. So it's been a really nice transition and one we needed with a defense that was really young this year. So he's stepped in quite nicely and works really well down there with our other three or four defenders.
Well, it's always good to have the All-America type goalie and Megan Taylor behind you. But four times to be Defensive Player of the Week is certainly impressive. Cathy, how do you feel about the effects of the time clock this year? 90-second clock, do you feel it continues to help the game?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I love it. I think, you know, when it first came into play last year, there was a lot of changes strategically, and, you know, that may have been made through the course of the year. This year, our big rule change is free movement. So now we're like any other sport out there where the whistle blows and you can keep moving. And so that's been a big change. It's taken a lot to get used to. But it's funny because now you go and watch a high school game and you can't believe we used to play that way. You know, you forget how quickly you forget the rules the way they used to be. And now we're looking at the speed of the game. It's really, you know, viewer friendly, and it's so up tempo, and it's going from one end of the field to the next. And it keeps the game going along really, really quickly. And I think it makes it fun to watch. It sure makes it fun to play and fun to coach.
It's funny, I was having a talk with Todd Carton, you know Todd, one of the biggest fans there is on women's lacrosse.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to him, and we were talking, that Megan Whittle set the record last week. And we're talking about set the goal-scoring record, you know, with people like Jed Adams, you know, there, and Taylor Cummings and the rest. And it, to me, it was kind of like quietly, consistently done. And then I looked at her stats before I called you today, 56 goals, 12 assists. She's been unbelievable. And Taylor might have overshadowed her a little bit, but talk about Megan's four-year career with you.
Yeah, it is. It is remarkable. And I think, you know, one of the cool things about, you know, her and all of these players that you can name is, and I think they'll all give credit to the people that play beside them, you know, the teammates and the people that have been crucial to their success, whether it's their feeds or opening up space, creating opportunities for them. For Megan to do what she's done has been phenomenal. So, you know, we talked as a team when it happened and said, hey, we're all a part of this. You know, this is something that's so cool and such a remarkable accomplishment, and something we're all so proud of. And it is really pretty awesome. I think the other thing to note too with Megan is, you know, here she's done this, and we play one of the toughest schedules in the nation. You know, she's face guarded from time to time. Sometimes I even pull her out of the face guard, you know, on my decision. And we'll play 6-on-6 to create more openings. You know, and so that I think is interesting too. There's a lot of games where we may play a lot of people off the bench and she's not even in there. And to be able to score the way that she has throughout her 4-year career is something that is really, it's just such an impressive accomplishment. And, you know, to think back to Jen's time too, when Jen did it, my goodness, and she had it in goals and assists. Like, it's just, it's so amazing what these players that have come through the University of Maryland program at different times, different phases, have been able to contribute to the overall success of the team. And, you know, we've gotten to the point where we have, you know, because of a lot of great things that everyone on the team's done and a lot of things that Megan's done. So it's a really nice, just a good accomplishment, I think, for the team as a whole to be a part of what she's done in her career.
May I say, the person I'm talking to, Cathy Reese, is a big reason for this continuation of success. You got to be a little prideful. Cathy, you've been unbelievable.
Well, thank you. I get so proud because obviously Maryland lacrosse means so much to me, having played there and been a part of so many teams over the years, but just so proud of all the awesome people that have come through the program before me, during my time, you know, after me, still under Cindy, and then that I've been able to coach. And just to watch, you know, how all of them have not only been fantastic players and athletes, they've gone on to just be awesome people. I think it's just so cool and represent the sport and our program so well out in the community. And so just something I'm really proud of. Yes, I love Maryland. You know that. I love Maryland lacrosse and being married to a Maryland lacrosse alum too. We've got just such passion for both Maryland lacrosse teams and look forward to continued success.
You certainly will. All right, let's take a look real quick at Penn State. Kaylee Hartshorn, I watched the Ohio State game wire to wire last week, and I think in the first half she only lost one draw, which kind of meant that it wasn't that close of a game. But
yeah, she's so good.
But Madison Carter actually has won more draws than her.
Is good. It's going to be a great, great matchup, and they've matched up well. You know, it's tough in the past. Madison Carter, Katie O'Donnell, they just have some really tough offensive players, and they've been tough for us on the draw. Callie's done a phenomenal job this year in adjusting as she's gone, and And I think, you know, her draw stats will speak for themselves with that. We also have Meg Syverson, who's transferred in from Louisville, who takes a bunch of our draws, too. So the two of them have really worked nicely together, been able to bounce ideas off of each other and, you know, find what works for us. What do we need to do to be successful? And then when one might be struggling, it's an opportunity for another, and they just can kind of work together to hopefully continue to create possessions for us. But they've done a tremendous job together this season so far.
I always thought some girls played a lot taller than they actually were, like certainly her name's slipping my mind, Taylor Cummings. But this girl Iverson, or Syverson, you utilized her last week in the draws. She's big. She plays tall.
She's a great player. What a great addition for us. We had two transfers this year, Meg Syverson from Louisville and Cathy Redkin from Syracuse, and they're both they've been key parts of our success this season. Both filling roles that we needed to be filled, and they've stepped up and rose to the challenge. And Meg is not just an offensive, you know, player for us that can score goals, she can take draws, and that just gives us some more depth in that area too. So nice addition for us and for both of those players.
Cathy, out of curiosity, now this Penn State team has three scorers who average more than three goals a game. All right, the girl Carter, Katie O'Donnell, same name as the all-time great Maryland field hockey player.
Mm-hmm.
And one other, Maria Auth, I think is her name.
Yep.
Do you assign a person to each one, or is it more, I know there you do a lot of help with some sliding, but how do you go about it when you have three scorers like that and maybe the rest of the team isn't prolific at scoring?
Yeah, I mean, they're definitely a tough team to defend. Because those three, like you mentioned, are really tough to stop. They've each taken their turns on us in the past and, you know, scored multiple goals in games, and it makes it tough to defend. And for us, you know, we're prepared as a team for them as a whole, you know, because a lot of them are, you know, Madison Carter on the end of some assisted goals, you know, so we need to be prepared for the whole kind of picture with it. But, you know, relying on our defense has improved from day one tremendously. And that's something that I've been really excited about. You know, Laurie Kennis has just done such a good job with them from where we started in February to where we are now. I mean, we're young and we had a lot of new faces back there on defense. We talked about Lizzie Colson kind of jumping in for the first time in Final Four weekends. And now she's a key part of it. And our transfer, Kathy Redkin, and Julia Bragg really holds it down back there for us, you know, and she's started for the last couple of years. So she's really our leader back there with Meg Darty, Meg Taylor. And so these guys are really playing together nicely right now and playing together well and working to get to their players where they need to be, you know. And so that's going to be key to our success tomorrow night, is making sure that, yes, we are helping each other out. We can play good 1v1 defense, but we are helping each other out too.
Yeah, you know, when we were talking about Megan Whittle, I think one of the things that makes it so incredible how many goals she scored is the fact it's not like she's surrounded by people who can't score. I mean, Caroline Steele is an assassin when she gets the ball inside of 10 feet. And Jen John, I don't like to use that word, but you know what I'm saying. I mean, she could find any part of the net. She goes low to high, high to low, corners. Again, the past few games I watched, she's been great. And Jen Giles and Brindy Griffin, and it doesn't stop. And you don't never get the feel that Megan is like looks for her shot all the time. And that's why I say it would kind of like hit me by surprise a little bit to see how great she really is.
Yeah, and we've done a really nice job. Credit to all the players this year showing the ball. And I think that's when we found that our offense is at its best, is when we're, you know, moving the ball. And you know, we have seven people in the field at any given time that can score. That's our goal, is we want to make sure that, you know, we're not limiting anybody's abilities or strengths there. Let's keep it moving and let's find each other and let's play together and play to our strengths and see what we can do. And so we've seen great things from Caroline Steele, like you said, and Callie and Brindy and Taylor Hench and Megan Whittle and Jen Giles and, you know, Grace Griffin coming through big as a freshman right now for us. So she's going to be fun to watch as well over her four-year career.
You know, you had one loss to North Carolina, a game that you really dominated and kind of lost at the end. I think it was in overtime. Other than that, you're undefeated. But yet you have two schools that are doing unbelievable, kind of ranked over you, Stony Brook and Boston College. And I know you're not looking at them yet, but Boston College doing that well without Kelsey Kent is pretty remarkable, isn't it?
It sure is. You know, Acacia, there you go, go Terps. You know, has done a really great job with Boston College. And, you know, I've seen some of them this year, but not a ton of them as we don't face them on our regular schedule or obviously in the ACC tournament. So, you know, she to lead her team to the national championship game, and now they're back at it. I mean, undefeated season. And then you've got Stony Brook up there as well. We don't play them either. So don't really, you know, I've been obviously focused a lot on them at all, or even, to be honest, talked about that at this point. You know, we're working on ourselves and what we need to do to try to succeed in the Big Ten right now with, again, two ranked opponents coming up. It's not an easy path ahead, but one we're preparing to take on the challenge.
I thought, as a person who was there last year, of course, I was biased because, as I predicted, both teams won the national titles last year. How did you like playing in the same event with the men? I thought it was fantastic. I thought your crowd on Sunday was unbelievable, and yet they stopped it. What was the reasoning behind that?
Playing up in Gillette was a nice. It was a really nice venue. They actually did a tremendous job in hosting. You know, initially had some just concerns about being, you know, as far away as we were from the venue. You know, again, Memorial Day weekend, it's kind of a tough thing to be there. But also in a venue that's that big, you know, to play in front of with in a venue that's that large. But at the same time, they did a really nice job of welcoming all the Final Four teams. They did just a nice job of making it a really special and memorable weekend for all the players. Yes, so we had a great crowd there on Sunday. To kind of have a bunch of other championships back-to-back was made for some quick turnaround, but lots of fans got to see some great lacrosse over the course of the weekend. So that was a really special experience for our student-athletes, and one obviously we're really psyched to come away with the win from and then watch our men succeed as well on Monday.
Yeah, it was fun. So the next 3 weeks are crucial before the tournament starts with a game against Penn State, then Northwestern next Thursday, guaranteed sellout for that game. And then,
hey, we hope so. We got a little special bobblehead night coming up on that game. So
who's the bobblehead of?
Hey, you'll have to come and get one.
Uh-oh.
But I think the first maybe 1,000 fans or something get one.
Well, I'll let the fans have it, all right?
It's nice. I think it's just something to celebrate all the national championships that have been won at the University of Maryland from the lacrosse program. So it's pretty cool.
It certainly is. Cathy, as always, a great guest, a great coach. It's great to talk to you. Good luck over the next few weeks, and hopefully, you know, we'll be continuing the discussion, as they say.
I like that, Bruce. All right. Thanks a lot, and we'll catch up with you soon.
You got it. Thanks, Kath.
All right. Go Terps. Bye.
All right. That's Cathy Reese. You listen to her... Mr. Producer, what an attitude. And that's how she projects to the team. She's a winner, best college coach in the country for lacrosse, arguably one of the best college coaches in the country with what she's done with the Maryland program. I think it's 4 titles in 7 years, and the other 2 were losses in the championship game. So, I mean, pretty strong. I might have those numbers a little bit off, but she's been phenomenal at College Park. All right, with that, we're going to head out to our first break. Back in a few minutes here on CBS Sports Radio 1300.
Welcome back to Coons Ford Terp Talk. Call 410-481-1300 now. Once again, here's Bruce Posner.
All right, back here on segment 2. On the phone right now, going to bring him in, my good buddy, the guy who operates Coons Ford of Security in Baltimore. My good buddy, Dennis Koulatsos. Dennis, welcome in today.
Hey, Bruce. Thanks for having me on.
Hey, Dennis, do you go back? Are you old enough to remember Bruno Sammartino, or is that just past your gauge there?
No, we came from Greece in 1973, and Bruno Sammartino was one of the very first wrestlers I'd ever seen. So I was a huge fan of Bruno, and God rest his soul as he departs at age 82, I believe.
Yes, 82. And what he, like, put an industry on the map. I mean, certainly the McMahons were behind it, but it was Bruno Sammartino who held the title for 8 years, and just everybody loved him, and he was just something special, and not like a 6'10" guy or whatever, but a guy who was built like a brick wall.
And I'll tell you why he appeals to, and wrestling appealed to immigrants, especially back then, Bruce, because when we came up to America, you know, football is complex, baseball is complex, but wrestling... You got a good guy and a bad guy, and it was very easy to follow. So that's why a lot of immigrants love pro wrestling to this day, because it was a very easy quote-unquote sport to follow?
Well, he took the title from Buddy Rogers in Madison Square Garden, and I could go into detail, and everybody my age out there would know it. But Bruno was something special, and he'll be missed. I mean, he's really been out of the wrestling scene. He was elected to the Hall of Fame the Wrestling Hall of Fame a few years ago, and I think Schwarzenegger introduced him.
He did. You know, I still follow pro wrestling close. We just had WrestleMania, and I'm into pro wrestling right now more so than ever. It's a great product, and it's great entertainment.
It looked like Ronda Rousey stole the show, didn't she?
She did a great job. We were all, you know, holding our breath. This was her debut, and look, would it translate? Would she be too stiff? Could she pull it off? But you know what? Triple H, Kurt Angle, Stephanie McMahon, they're all consummate pros. They all made her look real good, and she took full advantage of it. She stole the show. It's a seven-hour show, Bruce. And the last 2 hours were very flat. After her debut, it fell flat, but they're still buzzing about her appearance there.
You know, it's amazing. Rousey's unbelievable. I mean, she's really an attraction. I mean, since she got beat so bad a couple times, the UFC's been down a little bit. But I have to tell you something. I think that Stephanie McMahon's unbelievable for a 41-year-old woman who isn't a professional, you know, wasn't any kind of professional fighter, where all the people in the program just about were. The way she can sell, you know, her physicality is incredible.
Yeah, she's much more of a natural, like her father, than her brother is. She can really sell it. Again, as you mentioned, she took a beating, got great shape, and she sells the WWE like no one else. She's a great spokesman for the company.
Yeah, she sure is. All right, Dez Bryant, is he going to be a Raven, or is this just a pipe dream?
I don't think it's a pipe dream. I do think the Ravens will have to pay a little bit more than other teams to pick him up, because I think at this stage of Dez's career, it would be important with the quarterback he played with. And, you know, Joe Flacco, whether his fault or not, you know, he's not the kind of quarterback that's going to help you pad stats. And in Joe's defense, they put him in a West Coast offense. Joe is a vertical downfield chunk kind of a quarterback. And unless they tailor the offense differently to take advantage of Joe's arm and Dez's length, I don't see it as being a good fit, but they need another receiver prior to the draft. I think it would be great signing by Ozzie Newsome. He's great in the red zone. I would certainly go get him, but look, right now I think it's the Ravens, the Packers, and maybe even the Patriots have a shot at landing Dez. But it wouldn't surprise me if it was post-draft that he signs once the dust has settled. And I think he's also surprised that there's not more of a market for him. I think he thought he would have a lot of teams bidding for his services, and so far it hasn't been that brisk for him. The demand is just not there for his services.
So Adam Shepherd left put out the word today that Tom Brady is considering retirement in a much more serious tone than had been brought about before. What's your take on that? His wife's bugging him and wants him out.
Wow.
Doesn't want him to get hurt, no more concussions. And he did not report to the pre-camp that he didn't have to. But normally he's there, and him and Belichick supposedly are at odds. Is this a whole lot of smoke about nothing, or you think it's something there?
I think it's just a law, a pre-law, pre-draft law right now, Bruce, and it's a non-story to me. He's, from what I gather, he's reached out to his receivers and tight ends. He's planning on having, some get-togethers at his house, at his camp, to get his timing down with his receivers. So all indications, he's all in. He's committed. He's already reached out to the people that matter, his teammates, and from all indication, he's going to play this year and beyond.
Well, let's be realistic. We all know that if your wife really wants you to do something, you know, it's something you consider. And it doesn't mean you automatically do it, but apparently, you know, Giselle's opinion is that, you know, she makes a ton of money too. This is not a money situation, and the kids love for him to be home. I'm telling you, I think that if there's a true rift over this physical trainer between Brady and Belichick, if there's a true rift, I would say maybe a 20% chance he might retire.
Look, they're not going to always see eye to eye between Brady and Kraft and Belichick, but you know what? They've been able to collaborate over these years, and they'll figure it out. Tom Brady wants a sixth ring real bad. Now, once he gets that accomplished, I can see him stepping away. But he wants to put separation between himself and guys like Joe Montana and Troy Aikman. He wants to be on Mount Rushmore by himself. you're right. It's not about the money. It's about his legend, about his legacy. And right now, he's a legacy point of his career. And Giselle, she can want whatever she wants, but if, you know, this is Tom Brady we're talking about, and I don't think he has many years left, but I do think he has at least one or two left.
I think if he would have won the title, it could have been it for him. You know,
I don't doubt that. Yeah, I'm with you, but you know, the way they lost, it was so close, and by having Darius Butler and out of the game, look, there's some unfinished business up there in Foxborough, and look, they're the odds-on favorite to win the Super Bowl again. Why not play as long as he's healthy and got the appetite? You got to let the man be the man, and he's the man to beat. I think he's all in. I think it's much ado about nothing.
So last night I'm looking at Twitter while I'm watching the Capitals game and two basketball games, and I see you really got invested in that hockey game last night.
Well, you know what? There's a side story that Bruce. I got on the treadmill in the third period to figure, look, let me go for 20-25 minutes, and you know what? Double overtime, I'm still on that doggone treadmill. So I was really invested watching. What a great game. How about the Capitals coming back to narrow the gap 2-1?
Yeah, but they scored on a kick-in, and I have to tell you, that's 3-2 goal leads they blew. They are the ultimate word of chokers. I hate to say it, and I hope I'm wrong, and I hope they come back to win, and they certainly can. But holy cow, you're up 3-1 at home, yeah, and you can't hold on to the lead, and then you get two shots in overtime, and you can't score. I don't know, Dennis.
Hey, that puck bounces that funny way, Bruce, that you can't run out the clock, you can't sit on the lead. Anything could happen. Look, there's nothing like playoff hockey. I know you get very enthused and excited about it, and so do I. I'm glad they're going to keep playing for a while.
While we talk about something exciting, we got to talk about, and of course, I can't talk with the coaches about this because they don't want to hear about it, that potentiality of a monster game April 28th. I understand it's almost sold out, and they're capping the seats at 10 grand. Normally they don't, but this year, for whatever reasons, whether it's the marshals or the regulations, and they're just about sold out. So I bring that up for all Maryland fans who want to get to that game. Don't wait to the last second or think you're going to show up and go, because it's not going to happen. But hopefully still Shaq Stanwyck will be back. It'll be the last regular season game ever for a Stanwyck. Well, I should say ever. There'll be, you know, 15 years from now, babies will be playing. But the kids of Wells Stanwyck, this will be their last game, and Shaq, has to play in that. And you know, Hopkins has to be foaming at the mouth after the whooping Maryland put on him last year.
Yeah, you know, they'll be ready to play. And Bruce, you're right. All of our listeners out there, get your tickets now, because it's going to get sold out quickly. And don't be left out. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful matchup.
Hey, I know you're coming in next week to do the NFL draft. It's also Hopkins week. Why don't we try and corral Dr. Blumenthal to come in?
Oh, that'd be great. That'd be wonderful.
Yeah, you know, there's an all-time Hopkins fan, and also a lacrosse fan, too. But that would be super. All right, yeah. Dennis, what's happening at Coons Ford of Baltimore? I know there's zero. I know there's rebates. I know there's everything. Tell us what's going on this week.
Well, the big news, Bruce, direct mail offers $750 up to $3,000 to existing Ford customers. Check your mail. Don't throw it away. Don't throw the ads away. That's real money stackable on top of the already great, great rebates. We sold the Ford Focus today. $5,000 rebate, Bruce, plus $3,000 from the factory, plus a discount. It was about 60% off. I've never seen a deal like that before in my life.
Now, this extra money is not part of it's not part of the actual factory rebate. It's not part of the wow price this is the real deal, right?
Yeah, they're reaching out to their customer base. I don't know how they determine the dollar amount, but they look at how many vehicles you bought, how much money you spent with them, and it's a loyalty rebate, and it's direct mail. Nobody else has it. The amounts are different, but they are stackable with the rebates, and it's generating a lot of buzz and a lot of business right now.
Which it just makes it even more that you guys got, because you got enough as it is already. Dennis, what's wrong with the Orioles real quick? It's a disaster, I think.
Look, you know, you guys are big baseball fans, and what do you have, another 130 games to go? I think, look, they've got to get hot at some point, right? The bats have been silent, the pitching hasn't been good, but at some point they've got to turn it around.
It's been a disaster so far. They're 5-13, or maybe 5-14. They lost again today. They were up 4-2. Darren O'Day gave up a couple runs at the bottom of the eighth. Orioles, three runs, a three-run homer. And then at the top of the ninth, the Orioles tie it at five. And sure enough, Machado, not Manny Machado, Dixon Machado from Detroit, hits a home run to win the game in the bottom of the ninth inning. And the O's go down again. They're coming home for 11 games. They'll give them a shot to straighten it out, I think. But it's
okay, great. Good thing we have hockey playoffs, NBA playoffs, the NFL draft to keep us distracted from the Orioles at this time until they get their act together.
I'm afraid you're right. But you know what? We all still watch the Orioles. At least I do, and a lot of Oriole fans do. And we really want to see them turn around, even if they don't win the World Series or the pennant. And that certainly looks unlikely this year. Dennis, thanks a lot for coming on again. Tell everybody where they'll find you tomorrow. Of course, I'll be on at 4:30.
Yep, we'll be up the dial. Just make sure you Google my name, Dennis Koulatsos. Give me a call at 410-218-0337.
All right, Dennis, thanks for coming on, and we'll talk to you tomorrow.
You got it, Bruce. Go Ravens, go Terps.
All right. Wow, the Orioles, it's what happened? What is happening? You cover them, and it's a disaster. He's nodding his head. I'm my producer here, Mr. Abbott and Costello here. All right. All right, with that, we're going to head out to our second break. Be back in a few minutes. What do we have to talk about? We have to talk about the AD situation in Maryland. We have to talk about the Wizards. We have to talk about the Pelicans, who are playing on the top level with Anthony Davis, Rajon Rondo, and Drew Holiday, who's defensively has been incredible. They've taken the first two road games at Portland. NBA playoffs are just dynamite this year. LeBron comes back tonight. We'll be back in a few minutes here on CBS Sports Radio 1300.
This is Coons Ford Term Talk. Call 410-481-1300 now. Once again, here's Bruce Posner.
All right, back here on segment three, and hopefully we got the Viner boys on. Are you there?
I'm here, Bruce.
This is,
we got them both on.
Mason.
This is a technical miracle, all right? Well done.
It worked tonight.
It worked.
Bill's on his game tonight.
Bill told
Bruce.
Me it was going to work tonight. He promised me. So we got both the Viner boys on, Wayne and his son Mason, and we're going to start this off with Mason. Big game in lacrosse this week for the men. Ohio State, a replay of the national championship. What were your takeaways from last Sunday's come-from-behind victory for the Terps?
Well, Bruce, I think it was as bad as it could look without losing against Rutgers, a sloppy game that ends in a Terps win. But, hey, whatever it takes, a win's a win. I feel somewhat disappointed in the way the game played. I was hoping for a good game, but it was just bad on both teams.
Well, weather conditions were not the best, and there was a discussion about when you should know this, Mason, as a lacrosse player, as when the sticks get heavy, it's hard to make proper passes, and that's what they kind of blame. Now, he didn't blame it on, but Bryce Young, I had a few people tell me that that's why that pass was so poorly thrown that led to a tie score. But what were the favorable parts of the game, Wayne?
For Maryland, it was the comeback. For me, it was the comeback in the X. They end up with Austin Hemmingson taking the faceoffs, and he goes on a hot streak and gets a couple faceoffs that were desperately needed. One of our favorite players, Bubba Fairman, as you said in the press conference, Bruce, decided he wanted the ball. He got goals, I think, 6 and 7. They also get a goal from someone who's on the scout team last year, which is Adam DeMeo. I believe it was number 16, and then the big guns came out. Rotan scores on a bouncer, and then Connor Kelly gets his 8th point, finishes it off. 8 points, 8 assists. Maryland ended up with a 2-goal lead. They managed to run out the clock and win by 1. And you said it wasn't really a championship-level game, but that every team that goes to a championship has to get through a game like this.
Or maybe more. You know, you definitely have games like this. You just don't want to have them, you know, in the Final Four weekend, and it can happen. But, you know, it was a lot of turnovers, a lot of sloppy play, and Maryland got just creamed on the playoffs early on. And you're right. I think the big point of the game was the fact that Henningsen and Bonaparte came in and stemmed the tide a little bit. And then Henningsen really took over the fourth quarter. And did a super job. So this coming Sunday, Ohio State's not had a great year, desperate for a win. It's senior day for Maryland. That's always a tremendous amount of fun. And guys, I'll say, I'll ask Mason, it sets up a tremendous game that could happen on, if Maryland wins on Sunday, they guarantee a share of the regular season. But when you have to share it with Johns Hopkins, it's good to get it, but you want to beat Johns Hopkins. And Johns Hopkins, certainly on paper, should be able to take care of Michigan this week. So that game will be a monster next week if things happen as they should.
Yeah, it should, and the weather's looking good for Sunday, so hopefully there will be a big crowd out there. Ohio State lost four straight before Friday when they beat Michigan 8-5. Bruce, it was one of the great moments when Ohio State football plays the spring game and they have the lacrosse game either before or after it. But last week it was unfortunately canceled. But Ohio State looks back to some winning ways. So maybe they put up a challenge on Sunday?
I don't know. I haven't really watched it because they're really not on TV at all because they haven't been winning. And just some of their losses have been bad. But, it only goes to prove how great of a coach Tillman is that year after year he can come back and sustain. Look, Maryland might not win the title this year. They might not get there. They might not get to the Final Four. But they certainly are capable. They're number one in the land, arguably. I mean, the RPI has them number two, Albany number one. But they certainly would. The job he's done with this team has been incredible. But we can't talk about them without talking about Connor Kelly. This is 8 points again for him. Wayne, how do you describe this guy?
Guy makes passes where if you're just watching him as a fan, you can't find where he's going with the ball, but he sees somebody 20 yards away. He is a magician. He set the record last year for midfielder goals. He's moved up to attack. He is the guy. When you go talk to him, he seems like a little guy that you wouldn't be scared of at all. But, man, you put a lacrosse stick in his hands. Oh, my goodness. He's got range from 20, 25 yards. He can score inside and outside.
He packs a wallop. And the thing is now, records, certainly they could have won. And Penn State, you went to the wire to win. I mean, this Big Ten tournament is going to be very, very tough. When you look at the probable top four teams of Maryland and Rutgers and Johns Hopkins and Penn State, I guarantee you, in those four games, there are no upsets. Some people might say, well, if Maryland loses, it's an upset. But how can you say that when they just won two big games by one goal?
Okay. Bruce, Mason, you're not going to see a period like the second period when Maryland played Rutgers, where Maryland has seven penalties, a slew of turnovers. Maryland hasn't really played Maryland lacrosse. Mason, what do you think this is due to? A little midseason slump, even though they win the games?
No, I don't. I just think it's a different group of guys that are composed a little bit different than the normal team, but they got to fix that. You're not winning games with nine turnovers. It's almost like watching Maryland basketball when they won this year, when they just slid away every time. You turn the ball over too much in any sport, it's going to turn into some losses.
Yeah, what was
Bruce, how does Tillman get these guys to tighten up their games?
I predict that this week you won't see the turnovers. You won't. Now, I can't tell you why it happened last week. We're going to blame it on the weather or maybe some laissez-faire, even though they were playing the number seven team in the country. I can't answer that, but he has a way of cleaning these things up right away, and I think that we'll see a better Justin Shockey this week. But look, he's not afraid to use anybody. I mean, he put in his second midfield with 5 minutes left down by a goal, and DeMaio got the goal. And this is a guy who just utilizes everybody on the team. So I have total faith in Coach Tillman, and I am looking forward to Sunday, though, because I'd love to clinch at least a share of another Big Ten title. Let's move on down the line to the biggest topic that we're dealing with right now, and that is the AD. I'm going to start off with both of you. I got a feeling, I might be wrong, that Damon Evans is closer than we think.
Now have some new intel, and I can't disclose the sources, but he looks a little closer than he did a week ago. I think Mason and Jordan collaborated on a story that just got posted on TerpTalk about the AD situation. Mason, what do you hear?
Well, it's a bunch of guys are in the running right now, including former Tennessee AD John Cure, and my favorite guy, if they could snap him up, the current Oklahoma AD Joe Castellano, who is a College Park alum. The one thing, if it's not Damon Evans, that I want to see is a College Park alum. That's what these teams that are great at fundraising, have great programs that honor the fans and the members of the media, is they have guys that came from their school that are 100% committed for life. And I think that's what we want to see out of Maryland.
Does that mean does that mean there could be an attempt to steal Jeff Hathaway from where's he at? Hofstra?
Yeah, he's at Hofstra right now. I don't know. He's one of those guys that Maryland looks at, and then at the last second they decide not to hire. That's what seems to be Jeff Hathaway.
Okay, I'll give you that Hathaway and Joe Castiglione are both Terp alums. Joe's making $1.3 million a year, which is a lot more than Maryland was paying Kevin Anderson. I don't know if they're going to step up in that into that money pot there. Hathaway, even though he's a Terp, he hasn't really run a big-time program. He was at Connecticut. Their football, as we all know, was okay. It had Randy there. The basketball, he didn't do much in that. Lou Perkins, who was at Maryland before, brought Hathaway to Connecticut. Jeff inherited the program from Lou, stays there 8 years and leaves because of some NCAA improprieties. Bruce, did you know Jeff when he was at Maryland?
No, I did not. But a lot of the alumni did, and they liked him a lot. He was kind of like a small favorite. But, you know, Damon Evans has been with the team now for, what, 3 or 4 years? And he knows the players. He knows the situation. I just have a feeling that, I don't have any knowledge. But Tom McMillan has met with him, and Tom McMillan seems to have – is he the head of the search committee, or is there a search committee?
Mason, do you know if a committee's been named?
No, but Tom McMillan is considered a very important factor because of his slot as the chairman of the Division I AD union.
All right, so we don't know. We really were kind of early because this kind of just started, supposedly, after the six-month sabbatical, which ended, and so did Kevin Anderson's career. But let's take 1 minute and pay a little tribute to Kevin Anderson. When you go out, first of all, Kevin Anderson got us into the Big Ten. A lot of people still upset about it, but I think the majority realized that it had to be done for monetary reasons. And look at this structure that he's building, that he spearheaded, per se, that could really make the football program go on top. I think he's, gotten somewhat of a bad rap. Yeah, football hasn't worked out. Durkin sure seems like he was a right hire. But, I mean, was that him or was that Damon? I really don't know. But I just think that Kevin Anderson's done nothing but have Maryland in his heart. Maybe not in the past, whatever. I don't know what caused this separation, but I can't just trash him because I think he did a hell of a job while he was here.
Well, I don't think anything you said tonight trashed him. I know there's some people upset with him because of the Turgeon contract, not because they gave him an extension, but because they didn't have a buyout. And yes, Kevin Anderson gave us Randy Etzel. Some people aren't happy about that. But overall, when you look at the bottom line, is Maryland going to make enough money to pay their bills this year? The answer is yes. You say, why? You go, well, a lot of it has to go to Kevin Anderson. He's running the business, or was running the business of Maryland Athletics. Well, Bruce, you got to do me a favor. I know we're up against the clock, but I need you to give me a Bruno Sammartino Civic Center before you get off the air.
Civic Center. All right.
So who was Bruno Sammartino to you in the last 2 minutes?
You missed my segment with Dennis because we went into it in depth. He meant a lot to me, but he would speak in Italian when he first got here. And then in the middle of his Italian, which I can't speak, the word Civic Center would show up. All right. But he was something special. He really, him and Vince McMahon really put wrestling on the map, or maybe McMahon's dad. And he will greatly be missed. And we'll do a 10 bell for him on Saturday because we're just about out of time. But, guys, thanks for checking in. And we will talk to you soon. This is Bruce Posner. We're out of time. Have a great week, everybody. Go Terps. Go Lady Terps tomorrow against Penn State. And, of course, the men's Sunday against Ohio State. See you on Sunday on Coos Ford presents the Sports Maven.